Cool. Hi, everyone. So, yeah, really excited to have Damo here. I'm calling him Damo because I've always known him as Damo, and I just asked him, now you're a company director, do I call you Damian? And you said only your mum calls you Damian?
When I'm in trouble, yeah, that's pretty much it.
So I'm going to call him Damo. I first met you in about 1996.
Six.
There you go. And Damo was a student at the Academy of Contemporary Music. So I always love it when we get a guest come in who was in exactly the same position that you are. You know, when I first met Damo, you were playing in bands, you were at the Academy of Contemporary Music, which was one of the first ever, you know, popular music educational establishments. You know, some of you might be familiar with it. And then an interesting thing happened. I did a bit of teaching at the ACM, and my brother, who some of you met doing the guitar thing the other day, was teaching there as well. And he went on, he decided he was going to open his own school, so he opened the Brighton Institute of Modern Music, which you know is BIM, of which there's lots of them now. There's one in Bristol, there's one in Dublin,
Germany.
Berlin, there's one in Manchester. Anyway. So he wanted to open this school in Brighton, and he was looking for sort of company directors to sort of get in, put money in, but you know, get involved. And quite unusually, I think this is how it went, but you know, Damo, you were one of those directors, weren't you?
I was, yeah, 23 at the time.
Yeah, so 23 years old, so you graduated from the ACM.
Yeah.
And you know, he was asked to join some other quite high-end level people. One of the original company directors of the Brighton Institute of Modern Music. And that's really interesting. I just want to make a quick point now in that, you know, life is a constant audition, right? So we're going to be talking about auditions a bit today and auditions that might happen in the future and stuff. I wanted to realise that when you're at university, you're basically on an audition all of the time. So the reason that you know, somebody would go to somebody who's just graduated and said, hey, do you want to come and do this really high-risk, high-end business with me, is because of the qualities that Damo showed while he was a student, basically. So that's just a really important message. Anyway, so Damo was there at the Brighton Institute of Modern Music when it grew and grew and grew into the towards the monster that it's become now. But you got out after a while.
I escaped, I did.
After a while, with, you know, a decent amount of money, would
you say? Yeah, yeah, it's great.
Yes. So you were, we're going to talk a bit about money today. You know, Nigel, I think one of the important things about Think Tank is that we do talk about money, right? Because it is important, right? We talk about art a lot, and we've got to talk about money, because your aim, all of you in this room, right, is to pay the rent, pay the mortgage through music, to avoid getting a real job, right? You know what I mean? If that's not the case, leave the room now, okay? Because however you do it, whether it's teaching, whether it's being an artist, whether it's being, you know, doing what we're about to talk about today, you've got to just make money from the thing that we all love, right? So at the age of, how old were you when you got out, late 20s?
29, I think it was, maybe 30.
So you're a millionaire at 29.
It was nice.
Yeah, so there you go. But very, very, but this is a rags to riches to something else to hopefully
back to rags
story. So that's, you know, that's when I knew Damian, because I was there at him at the beginning as well. Damo, sorry. And I'm going to leave you there. So, and then it's going to be really interesting if you talk about the gin. How? Because I don't know what happened to you after.
Went missing.
Yeah.
I grew a big beard.
Grew a beard, went missing. So Damo's going to take the story from there, and it's going to be relevant to all of you. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Damo, please. Ah!
Thank you very much. I think that was the best intro I've ever had in my life. That was amazing. This place is amazing, by the way. I'm so happy to be here. I've been excited about this for weeks. So thank you for having me. So yeah, I mean, that's pretty much up to a certain point. One thing I would add is I love the same as Jim. I love the fact that I have sat in the same place as you thinking, what am I going to do? And just slightly before the ACM and the BIM thing, one thing to add is I went through my GCSEs and I failed all of them. And I remember walking home and thinking, oh, my mother's going to go mental. She's going to call me Damian. And I went home and I said, oh, I didn't get any. And she was surprisingly nice about it. And then she went, but don't worry, because you can just reset the entire year all over again. And I thought, oh, God. So I did. I went back to school. I did another year while all my friends had left to go to do A-levels. I went to a different school. I got held back a year. I did my entire GCSEs again. And I failed them all again. Fantastic. I got one GCSE. So my life plan then was I'm going to need to figure this out in music because that was pretty much the only skill I had. And whilst I was a student at ACM, the only way, because I come from Swansea in Wales, and the only way I could afford to live, the very different living expenses in Guildford compared to where it was in Swansea, the only way I could live was by doing covers. That was pretty much it. It was a very different world back then. And so I learned very quickly, no gig, no food. Simple as that. There was no other option because there wasn't the world of student loans available to me at the time. So it was no gig, no food. So I had to learn very, very quickly, which I did. And then I actually personally believe the reason why I was able to go into to do BIM and other stuff is from what I learned from doing a covers band. Because whilst I was doing a covers band, I was managing people, I was managing cash flow, I was managing the finances, I was managing the marketing, I was managing the branding, I was having to manage effectively a tiny business in one thing. So, and because of that, you know, in a micro format, that's what business is, whether it's in a covers band or whether it's in a massive multinational company. Effectively, the rules are still the same. You're still managing people, you're still managing money, you're still managing branding and marketing and sales and all that kind of stuff. It's just there's more people involved and there's more aspects of each bit. But I really believe that I learned so much about business whilst doing a covers band. So fast forwarding to 2009. So I walked out of BIM and I said, don't worry. There was a few issues going on at the time and we were having some arguments. And I said, you know what? It's fine. I'll just go and do something else. It's not a problem. And I remember walking out, getting in my car, driving home. And on the way home, I remember thinking, what am I going to do for the rest of my life? Like at the time, as much as I sold BIM and I made a lot of money from it and that was fantastic, but I didn't think that at the time. I left and I just thought, a million what ifs go through your head. What if I never work again? What if I lucked out? What if I don't get paid anything? What am I going to do? And thoughts went back to covers bands, business, all those different things. And it took 9 months to sell the company. It's a very stressful time because all my friends worked at the college. So I didn't see them because obviously, you know, we weren't keeping in touch at that point. I'd left and, you know, I'd gone away. They were still in their day-to-day life seeing each other and I wasn't there. So what I did was I just needed something to do and get my teeth into and take my mind off what was happening. So I started a couple of bands and I thought one of them with my brother-in-law, I was like, I will, he's a musician as well, I'll start a band with him and we can go out. He was, you know, a great musician. We can go out, we can make some money from playing and we can just enjoy it. I didn't at the time have a company in mind. I had a few ideas for what I was going to do and we put a band together. We put two bands together and something magical happened for me, which was in 2008, there was a massive big crash in the whole world economy. Everything just, the 2008 crash, everything went wrong in 2008, which was a complete disaster. Apart from for me, because at that point, I just accidentally stumbled across a winning formula. And that was, I'd put together, because I've been doing these covers bands for a long, long time, and I'd put these covers bands together, and it would always be 5 to 9-piece bands. You'd have brass sections, you'd try and make it as big as possible and expensive as possible. And all of a sudden, 2008 hit, and no one had any money to, or you know, they were worried about it. No one had any money to spend on their weddings or on their corporate entertainment. No corporate parties were around. It was just a dark time. And I put together a 3-piece band whilst everyone else was doing 5-piece bands and doing what I'd done for 10 years before, which was playing I Will Survive and YMCA and Blame It on the Boogie and all those sort of slightly cheesier things, which was going on. And just for fun, I put together a 3-piece band with drums, guitar and bass, and we both decided that we could sing. And it was just purely so we could have some fun and go and play. And I took it to all of the agents in the country, pretty much. And I said, I've got this great idea, and it's going to be a really small three-piece band, and we're going to play. The Kings of Leon had literally just dropped Sex on Fire and the album, and Mr. Brightside was massive, and a bunch of songs around that time revolved around Stereophonics and Feeder and other stuff. And I basically said to them, this is what I'd like to do. I'd like it to be a bit more modern rock stuff. And all of the agencies said, you can't do that. That's ridiculous. You'll terrify people. Status quo at a wedding is scary. So you can't turn up and you can't play Rage Against the Machine. And I was like, oh, it's a real shame because I really like it. But I said, don't worry, I'll just go and do it in pubs and I'll do it myself because that'll be fun. And then I'll have my functions band, which I'll talk about in a minute, which will do the weddings and that kind of stuff. But 2008 came along and changed everything because no one had any money. And at the same point, there was like a switch that went off in people's heads, which was people getting married at between the age, on the whole, first marriage between the age of 23, 24, and 33-ish. So these people had grown up with a different set of music and they're looking at it thinking, I haven't got any money. And more importantly, I've just realized, I don't want to listen to YMCA. That's just cheesy. I don't want to do that thing where everyone sits down when they play sit down. That's really like, it's just not what I want. I grew up listening to different music. I mean, I'm a lot older than you guys, but I grew up listening to Rage Against the Machine. So I'm like, why would I want YMCA at my wedding? That doesn't work for me. So these two things went together very well. People didn't have a lot of money, so these three-piece bands became an option. And at the same point, the music that people wanted at their wedding became more acceptable to have guitar-based rock because Kings of Leon had dropped that album, which meant another bunch of similar bands were out doing the same thing. So I put this band together, and all of a sudden we started getting gigs because we were the only option, because everyone else was a lot more expensive. And this is something I have a massive bugbear about. At the time, there was a going rate for bands, and it was a ridiculous amount of money. And there was this thing in weddings where people go, you want a waistcoat? Oh yeah, top man, 20 quid. Oh, you want a wedding waistcoat? Oh yeah, sorry, that's £300. And you go, but it's a waistcoat. And you go, yeah, but it's a wedding waistcoat. You want a cake? Oh, it's a tenner. You want a wedding cake? Oh, sorry, it's £1,000. You want a band? It's 200 quid. Oh, you're on a wedding band. Oh no, sorry, it's £1,500. And I was like, I don't understand. Like, I understand the pressure of a wedding, but I don't understand the correlation of going, I'll play a pub for 200 quid, but then the next night I'll play a wedding for £1,500. That's ripping people off. That is unfair by holding people to ransom because it's their wedding. And all the bands did it. And we came along and we slashed the prices and we said, we'll just go out. We didn't have to worry about VAT or any of that kind of stuff. We'll just go out and we'll go for 600 quid. That's what we'll just go out for 600 quid and the agents can put their fee on and we'll just do that. So we got loads and loads of gigs. So much so that one agency in particular, we had about 12 agencies that we were on the books for. But as some of you guys might find, you might be on agencies' books. Doesn't mean they're going to get you gigs. It just means that you're on the books. Just in case someone comes along and sees something about your band that they like and inquires with the agency. So a lot of agencies will take you on. Doesn't necessarily mean that you will get gigs because they'll have their favorite bands or their exclusive bands that they look after. But we started getting a lot of bands, especially through one agency, and they became very good friends of mine, and they said, we could book you guys five times over in the summer. And it's a shame because we don't have any other bands like it. So I said, well, I've got loads of friends and ex-students that would love to be a part of this. Why don't I get them involved with this? And then you can have some extra bands, I can get my mates some work, and everyone's a winner. And they were like, that's amazing, thank you very much. So I went and started putting these bands together with friends, and they kind of fell apart. So, and I just thought, oh, it's really simple. You just do A, B, and C, and they fell apart. So I realized that it needed, because they didn't have the experience, it needed me to kind of just hold it together a little bit. So what I did was I bought the gear and I did the marketing, I did the branding, I did the whole lot, and I just said to them, all you've got to do is turn up and do what you do best, which is play guitar and sing, play bass, play drums, whatever it is that you're doing in a band, that's all you've got to do, and then we'll do the admin side. And then that turned into a business, which is DK Management in 2009, and I remember distinctly saying, I've come from a music education background, and whether I do another school or whatever I'm going to do, I want to think of another business that I want to build. And DK Management had got to the point where it had three bands. And we were constantly getting asked for more bands. So I said, well, do you know what? We'll do another two. We'll get to five. And then that will be a little business that'll turn over some money, which will be great. I'm feeling a bit more confident about myself now that I've built a little mini business to do something else. And then five got full. So then it was maybe seven. And then it was 10. And then it was 12. And then it was 15. And then we realized petrol prices were going up and up and up and up. So the bands were staying at the same price, but the bands were getting more expensive because in order to get a band from Brighton, which is where we were based, to Manchester, it would cost £700 for a band and then £400 for travel and accommodation between all the cars. So people don't mind paying £1,000 for a band, but they don't like it when they pay 700 quid for a band and £300 or £400 for travel because you feel like you're paying for the wrong bit, if you like. So what we did was we split the country in half and we said, what we'll do is we'll build more bands up north and we'll have a north-south divide. And that way the north bands can do all this bit for cheaper and the south bands can do all this bit for cheaper. And then 15 became 17, which became 18, and then 20. And then we split it into quarters and we came over to Bristol and Bath so we could have more of a hub over in the west side of the country. And then from there we went up to Newcastle and a few other bits. So now we have 30 bands. And we're looking at a meeting this week with Dan. You can't sit still, because the one thing you need to realize about being in one of these commercial bands is it changes so fast nowadays. The industry's changing fast, and the reason for that is because people are getting married quite young, and they're used to modern songs. So a song will come and go very quickly. So if you're still playing Call Me Maybe, like a lot of bands will see that as a modern song. It's not a modern song, that was like, what, 3-4 years ago? So all of a sudden, you need to be changing your set list and changing the marketing and doing the social media quite regularly. So we had our 30 bands, we're looking to take it up, we're potentially looking at expanding into different countries. And the idea is still the same. It's very, very simple. We don't reinvent the wheel. We've come across a winning formula, which is we keep the costs down, we look for musicians for DK Management that want to be out playing a lot but also have other aspirations in their career, so they're not looking at putting all their creativity into a covers band. Most of our guys are in originals bands, some of them work full-time, so we're not looking for that massive creativity. And then we build niche bands in different areas and we keep the cost down, and the way we keep costs down is by minimal amounts of people. So functions bands. It makes me want to puke when someone uses the word functions band. I hate it. I'm at the back going, functions, because when I think of a functions band, and I'm sure the same as you, what I actually think of is colorful waistcoats, or my pet peeve, colorful ties. Like when people have colorful ties and they go, yeah, but that's a bit quirky because we've got orange ties or green ties, or sometimes we have multicolored ties because Jim wears a yellow tie, Damien wears a pink tie. And all of a sudden you're like, that doesn't work anymore. That was brilliant in 1995, 2000, 2001-ish. The thing is what people want right now in 2017 is they actually want a real band. They want the band off the front of NME, they want the real band off Q, they want the real band sometimes off Kerrang magazine because that's what they've grown up with. Ideally, they'll say, I want the Killers. Unfortunately, they cost £300,000 to come to my wedding and I only have a budget of £1,000. So therefore, what can I get that is the closest thing for £1,000? And that is the realest, closest thing to a real band that you can get. So I just want to show you one thing on Damien's MacBook Pro. So this is no longer. This idea of dressing up funny because it'll make people laugh and having in jokes doesn't work. This idea of pink waistcoats and sunglasses indoors and that jacket that's on the front, whatever that is, this idea of going, yeah, but we're rock and roll, and then just it feels like everyone's dad. And this idea of of this, when it comes to names, Super Groove. Hey everybody, we're Super Groove. Oh God, it's just, you know, why would you take pride if that's your band? When you just go, what do you do for a living? Well, I'm in Super Groove. It's just not. For me, I'm like, well, I don't want to be in Super Groove. I'm sure they're lovely people and they're probably really good musicians, but I don't aspire to that. And what I want to do is I still aspire to stand on stage and play bass for me and sing. And I want to be proud. I want you to look at me play and go, that's really good. I still aspire to that. I don't want to ever get to the point where I'm turning up for the money or just regurgitating the same thing again and again and again 20 years later because it's what I've always done. Because I can promise you, when you start getting into doing functions, when you start getting into doing in commercial bands, covers bands and commercial bands, I promise you it's brilliant for a while. But when it starts getting into year 3 and year 5 and year 7 and year 10 and year 15, and that is what you do because that's what makes it can make a lot of money, if you don't enjoy it, if you don't enjoy gigging, because it can be a very tough life, then it becomes very, very stale very, very quickly. And for me, I didn't do Super Groove. But I did when I was a lot younger in order to pay my way through college, and that was more the norm, and I didn't know any different. I did undercover. Do you like what I did? Yeah, that is one step away from a band called One Foot in the Groove, is what that is. So I did undercover, and we played working men's clubs because I didn't really know how to break into weddings, which was fine because we got really good and we were young. And that was the thing back then. You were allowed to do that. And lots of bands would turn up and they go, well, what's brilliant is we play disco music, but then we dress up in this really weird kind of almost racist way where everyone dresses up and puts fros on and has these kind of pimp clothes and plays. And you just think, like now you'd be like, why would someone do that? But back then, man, that was just a thing. Bands would have these big flares and they were like, but it's funny because the band dresses up as 70s porn stars, I guess. And that all that's gone. And so the reality is nowadays, when people want bands, they want the real thing, which is the marketing, the musicianship, and the songs. So it is completely acceptable nowadays. When, like, I'm coming to the end of me playing, doing this because I am getting busier, but I've been doing this for a long time. And the first band I started this business with is a band called The Indie Killers. And it was just me and two of my mates, and we just enjoyed playing. Now, for me, it's just a way of getting out of the office because I'm in the office a lot and I'm working and I want to be playing. It still terrifies me not to be playing gigs on a regular basis. But at the moment, I'm gigging 130 times a year. And that could be anywhere. So Saturday night, we're playing in Hungerford, which is 2 hours from Brighton. Get back to Brighton at 3:30 in the morning. The next day after that, we're playing over in Canterbury, which is another sort of 2 hours on Sunday. Then I've got a few days off. So, you know, we would, in the summer, do 4 gigs in a row, and it could be anywhere from going from Brighton to Manchester, Lancashire, Wales, Cornwall, Norwich. Where there's a gig, we'll play it. It's a lot of travelling. So, this is an advert which I wanted to play, hopefully the sound will work, for the company that we built. And it just, hopefully, it'll give you a snapshot of more what today's commercial band industry is like. So whilst that is an advert, you can see behind it the standards of what we are trying to achieve, which is this is now big money. The commercial band industry is big, big money because the wedding industry is big, big money. And not only are you attaching yourself to weddings, but you're attaching yourself to a corporate market. You're attaching yourself to anywhere that someone might want a band for a party. So it is big, big money, and you can sustain a career, you know, very easily if you put the groundwork in and you get the band right. And, you know, one thing when we met earlier on, I'll talk about money all day long because I personally think that the money side to it is stuff that I talk to a lot of musicians. I've met a few of you today that we've been in touch before via the social media thing that I run. And when it comes to money and musicians, there's a really weird thing where musicians and money, they don't like to talk about it, but it's really, really important that when you leave here, you are able to sustain yourself. So can I just ask, is it a 3-year course?
Yep.
How many of you guys are first years? Okay, how many are second years? And how many are third years? Okay, so a good even split. So third years, how much are you panicking right now? Because it's gone fast, hasn't it?
Yeah.
As a third year, all of a sudden you're like, first year, we'll have loads and loads of fun. Second year, we'll knuckle down a bit more. And third year, that's when it really gets heavy. And all of a sudden, you blink and it's the third year and the exams are coming up and a final projects and it goes fast. So third years, you should be panicking. And you should be panicking, absolutely. But second years, I can tell you something, you should be panicking. And first years, you absolutely should be panicking. Because, I'll tell you why. Because when you guys leave, you know, we're talking about today about commercial bands. But when you guys leave here, at the end of your course, you have to compete with me. And I am fucking amazing. And I'm not kidding. When it comes to being a bass player, I'm not a great singer, but when it comes to being a bass player, understanding marketing, the way I look at it is this. All gigs are my gigs. You have to take them away from me because that's my business. I'm happy to help anybody to get into this industry, 100%. But I want the gigs. I want to be the number one. I've only got 130 gigs. It's nearly killing me doing these gigs because one of our other bands got about 110 and we were doing 105. I was absolutely not going to have that. So we basically redid our entire marketing so we could get 130 gigs. Now, I'm nearly dead, traveling around everywhere, putting this marketing in. But when you leave, you have to compete with the likes of these guys. And you saw some of those guys, I mean, those are just a couple, but some of these guys, they go on to do some massive, massive things. And why wouldn't you? Because if you're playing 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 gigs a year, you are getting more familiar with being on stage, with playing your instrument, with playing with more guys, with networking, with understanding how it works. Like, everything is improving at all times because what better way to get better at playing live than being out playing live? It's a great way of learning your trade. So, I personally think it is there for the taking. And at the moment, in 2008, we started this one band and everyone said it wouldn't work and it did. And now everybody plays Kings of Leon, Sex on Fire. Like, why wouldn't you play that? Everyone plays Uptown Funk. Everybody plays Mr. Brightside. They're just standards that go in your set. And so breaking into that noise with the agents, because an agency, there's a few in the country, but an agency with 300, 400, 500 bands on the books, times by 10 agencies, if you're gonna get onto their books and actually get work, you have to do something pretty special. So in my opinion, you are looking at how you can either outmarket me, which is gonna be very difficult because I now have a company with 30 bands and at the moment we do about between 1,500 and 2,000 gigs a year with our management company, which brings in money. So when we put our next band together, we put more money into it. So outmarketing me is gonna be very difficult because it's expensive. And for me, it's not a gamble to put £5,000, £6,000, £7,000 into building a new band. For you guys, that's probably too much of a gamble to put that much money in, especially without the experience of having done it a million times before. So if you can't outmarket me, or you're not prepared to outmarket me, the one way you can, and I'm giving you my trade secret, so don't tell anybody, the one way you can is by coming up with a niche that either I haven't thought about, or I've just thought that'd be quite good, but it's not really my thing. Just like the Indie Killers did in 2009, where we said, we're gonna play more rock, we're gonna be a rock and roll wedding band, and it took off. And it could be many, many different things. It still has to have, and I say this a lot, you can't redefine the wheel of the business side to it, but you can redefine the wheel of the product itself. So for example, if you said, do you know what our niche is 90s boy band and girl bands, that would work because no one else is doing it. And as a band, you're not trying to get 1500 gigs a year. You're trying to get, for the first year, 20 or 30 or 40 or 50. And nostalgia is massive. It's a massive thing. So if you're playing hits of the 90s, and it could be, you could have sections which has got UK garage, it could have sections which has proper boy bands, you could be doing NSYNC, Backstreet Boys, you could be doing Bewitched, you know, whatever it is, that gives you an angle and it gives you a niche. Rather than just saying, we're gonna be another band that plays Uptown Funk, and we're gonna be another band that plays Mr. Brightside, and we're gonna be another band that plays Sex on Fire. I'm not saying you don't play those songs, but you don't market those songs. Because when you play Uptown Funk, the crowd go, they want that. They will go, whether you play 24 Karat Magic, whether you play Uptown Funk, the crowd will like that. But if you market that, if you tell the world that's what you do, then you are going into a big cauldron of noise of thousands of bands that also did a video of Uptown Funk. And if you go on YouTube and you type in Uptown Funk cover, see how many people have done a cover of it. And you go on any agency in the country and you just start clicking through bands and you see how many people have sat there in their meeting of their band and said, we need to do some marketing, what should we do? Hey, Uptown Funk would be a good one. No, Uptown Funk is a terrible idea now. That was a brilliant idea when it came out. But now 24 Karat Magic is the new one. If you're gonna get on the Bruno Mars track, it has to be that. And we are constantly doing marketing for new songs. So Rag and Bone Man, I've got guys in the studio this week recording Rag and Bone Man. I've also got guys in the studio this week recording the new Ed Sheeran song that's just come out, because that is going to be the next big wedding first dance song. I can't even remember what it's called, but it's the slow one that he's just released, gone in number two. It's gonna be massive. It's gonna be everyone's wedding song. So I just thought, we need a band. And those decisions are huge, because we recorded Thinking Out Loud about a week after it came out from Ed Sheeran. And I listened to it, and I just thought, oh my God, I'm gonna be singing this a lot for a while, because this is a first dance song. And so we recorded it, and what do you know? It got us just, it probably brought us in another 30 or 40 gigs. And as first dances, I probably sang it, I don't know, 60 times last year in different places. They all think it's original, but it's not, but it means something to them. So your marketing stuff, which is just coming out, you're almost second guessing what's going to be massive. And this is a really interesting thing, because covers used to be a dirty word. You know, when I was a kid, the first band I was ever in, it was called Mosh or Die. You can imagine the sort of music that Mosh or Die used to play. So the idea of playing, at the time, cheesy songs, when I wanted to play Pantera songs, didn't really go together. And that was the same for years. Musicians would go, ugh, covers, ugh, I'm not doing that, fine. But then over the last few years, a few things have changed with YouTube and with social media. Things like Boyce Avenue came along and did their kind of acoustic-y versions of covers. Didn't do any original stuff. And they built this huge following online. And then along came a million others, Tyler Ward, just all these kind of acoustic covers. And then all of a sudden, everyone went, that's a really good way of getting an audience. So everyone started doing covers on YouTube. And the ones that got through were the niche ones. Has anyone heard of Leapfrog Studios? Oh, you're gonna love it! Right, Leapfrog Studios is effectively Mosh or Die covers. In fact, I'm gonna play you something. Just because it's that good. It's that exciting. I think I've got, do I have the internet? Oh, I might not have the internet. Oh no, I'm on the cloud. I can't show you.
Ed, can you log in?
Yeah, if you can log me in, I've got to show you Leapfrog Studios. You're going to love it. But whilst what he does is he takes literally covers of anything from R&B, acoustic, Let It Go, like anything like that, and he does full-on comedy metal versions. It is amazing. So he's doing his metal stuff. Boyce Avenue are doing their acoustic stuff. Then you get who I saw last night. I went to a gig last night and I saw Postmodern Jukebox. Anyone heard of Postmodern Jukebox? Amazing. Okay, so Postmodern Jukebox is this kind of 1920s jazz music with these phenomenal singers, live singers that pull it off live. I went to see him last night. Just unbelievable. And they have a huge following online. And because you get this niche of going, this is the jazz aspect, this is the metal aspect, here's an acoustic thing, all of a sudden people are going, yeah, but covers is just a way of a vehicle for building an audience, and then it's up to you to put your stamp on it, whether you want it to be heavy or acoustic, or, you know, anyone heard of Pentatonix? Pentatonix is basically just a vocal group, and it's purely just four or five guys and girls that just sing with no instruments whatsoever. I mean, they are phenomenally talented people. And again, they don't do any original songs. None of these guys do. And they've built a massive audience and are able to make a really good amount of money, especially now that they're touring it, a really good amount of money from covers. And I find this fascinating that covers is no longer a dirty word. Cheesy covers is a dirty word, but doing covers, doing them in a really, really talented way, that is the way to do it.
I've just
sorted
out, yeah.
You've done it?
Yeah, I've done it.
Give a round of applause, please.
Hey! Right, check this guy. This guy started a few years back. He lives in Norway. And let's go with, I think this is my favorite one I've seen. So you get the general idea. He's a loony. But he does all these covers and they're really, really fun. But look at the most important bit. Most important bit of this entire video. Look at this. 6.5 million views that he's had. Nearly 1.5 million subscribers. So he started a studio and this was his way of basically marketing his studio. Now, you'll make a lot more money from not only the YouTube clips, but also the endorsements, the sponsors, and everything else that he gets, probably the tours that he gets to do, much, much bigger. So covers isn't a dirty word anymore. And so it comes down to then is what your niche is and how you market it, because marketing is very, very important, and how much you charge, because there is a very, very important price point. And here is something that I see all of the time. and that is bands will either be in college or leave college, and they'll just sort of go, how much is the going rate for a covers band? Oh, it's like £1,000. I'll just charge that. Now, the band I'm in probably charge about £1,000. So how on earth are you going to get gigs? When I've done nearly 2,000 gigs in my life, 1,500 to 2,000 gigs in my life. Like, I've done 6 gigs in 5 days, probably 3 or 4 weeks ago. So I'm constantly, the gear I use is developed over all this time. My knowledge of the sound of every single room that we've ever been in, the trust that puts in the agencies for putting me out on a gig, knowing that if something goes wrong, if I cannot deal with it, probably there's not many people who can, just purely on an experience point of view, because I am doing this all the time. So if the desk goes down, what happens? If the monitors go down, what happens? If the bride and groom split up, you know, any of these tiny things that go wrong. So all of these things put faith in the agents. So when you come along and you say, but we're gonna charge the same as them because that's the going rate, it's not. There is no going rate. What the going rate is, a supply and demand issue. The going rate is, what can you get to start with and build on from there? And from there, you are basically leveraging yourself, saying, hey, we might not have this experience or gear, but we've got a niche. And I have to say, if you are looking at a different price point, wherever that may be, that's where we fit in. Or the other thing you do is you say, no, we're not going to do the same as all the other bands. We're going to put the price point way, way higher. We're going to charge £3,000 for a gig. That is doable. As long as, because people aren't stupid nowadays, the price point matches the quality of the band. So has anyone seen Justin Timberlake's band live? Okay, has anyone seen Bruno Mars's band live? They're phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. You've got to compete with that, because again, just like someone says, I want the Stereophonics, but unfortunately I can't afford them, so I'm going to have the Indie Killers. They've got to come to you and say the same thing. I'd love to have Bruno Mars's band, but it's too expensive, so I want the next best thing. If you have, and I deal with this a lot, a 9-piece band with brass and keyboards and guitar and 2 singers or 3 singers, and you have this huge band so that you have to charge £2,000 or £3,000 to make it work, then you better believe that that band needs to blow people away. And the marketing does too, because people don't care that you've got extra musicians to feed. They won't look at your band and say, yeah, but there is 9 of us and we all want to go out for 150 quid. They won't care. They'll just go, no, I'm paying £2,000 when I can pay £1,000 and get this product over here. So in which case, you have to have a great niche and your band has to be amazing. I mean, amazing, amazing. If you've got a brass section, you can't just play Superstition. Because I can play Superstition with, I can literally grab a guitarist and a drummer and we can jam Superstition and get through it in a way that'll get people to dance right now. I'll sing, I'll play bass, we'll have a guitarist, we'll have a drummer or a keyboard player. Literally, it's that simple. You can't do that. That isn't acceptable. Just because you've stuck a brass section going, that isn't good enough. So if you're gonna do it, you have to go down that route of Bruno Mars's band, and you see what they're like live, you see the way they move on stage, you see what they wear on stage, you see how they interact on stage, you see the harmonies from the BVs, from the musicians, let alone the singers. It is a massively high standard. So your price point is incredibly important, and you can pitch it anywhere. You can start off by saying to the agents, no, we're gonna do 10 gigs for free. Just to show you, you can put us anywhere. You can put us in a pub, you can give us a wedding. We're gonna show you how good we are for nothing, and we'll prove to you that we are worthy of doing that. You could do that, or you could.
Has that happened?
I did that. Yeah, I've done that with every single agency. In fact, get this, not only have I done that with every single agency, but I'm working on, as some of you know, on some social media stuff, and I want to do more of this stuff where I'm actually doing what I used to do at BIM, where I get to do workshops and lectures for the music industry and helping musicians. And I've got a friend over in Nashville who is basically helping me put together a strategy to do it over in America rather than here. So the first thing I thought is, I haven't taught for a while, I need to be doing these sort of workshops. So I just said to Katie, who's my PA, I want to be doing more of these things. So we did a video. I'm going to come to your college and I'm going to just do a talk. And we had about, well, we've got 12 in March. And they are in Scotland. And that's as far up as we go. I've got Exeter. Well, I've done Exeter. The other day I was in Suffolk. I've got everywhere in between. I'm not getting paid for any of them. I don't want to get paid for any of them because I want to know that I am going to make my product so good that when someone does finally say, I want you to come and do this, then when I put the price on it, I will feel comfortable saying, yeah, but the reason why I charge this is because I am the best I can be at it. And then I will look into price points. But I think going out and doing stuff for free, not because it's free, but doing stuff because you genuinely want to learn and you genuinely want to experiment, because experimenting is so important. Like right now, set lists for me is another big bugbear. And so when I have a set list for a band, I take all the songs that we've got and I print them out on a piece of paper and then I cut them out into strips. So I've got every single song on it and I put them on the floor. I just have a big space on the floor. And what I do is I literally kneel on the floor and I start just moving them around into different spaces so I can have a look at the set and then I can take it there. I mean, I will do that for an hour, at least hour and a half, just trying to visualize how it works before putting it into Spotify. So we're looking at so many tiny details, but then I'll go out and do a gig and go, oh, that didn't work. That was awful. Because sometimes when you do some of your songs, sometimes you'll have the right song at the wrong time. So you'll have a really, really great song that works. If you put it at the wrong moment of the set, you can kill the entire night, even though it's a great song. So if you walk out on stage and play Sweet Child of Mine, people will go, I don't know what happens next. Like, that's the end. Like, I don't know what to do next. So your set list is so crucial. So, you know, so many bands, little tip, so many bands do this thing where they go, our first set is a bit of a kind of like, you know, breaking the ice. But then the second set, that's when we go for it. No way. I am exactly the opposite way around. I am going to get on stage and I am musically going to punch everyone right in the face. That's what I want to do. I am going to demand. I'm not going to tell them we're partying. I am demanding that we're partying. I'm going to stand on stage with the best song I can possibly play that night. Not the best end song, the best song I can start with that set, and I'm going to say, you and me are going to have a party tonight. This is going to be amazing. Don't go to the bar. Don't chat with your mates. Come down here and let's have a party. Instead of what most bands do is they stick them all at the end and go, God, that's when everyone's drunk and they go mental. But most people go home from a wedding earlier than the end. So the first six songs of a set list are so important to play. Killer song, killer song, killer song, killer song. It's so crucial. So how would you know that unless you go out and actually perform those gigs and you're watching the crowd and you're experimenting and then you make the next one and the next one? So these are the areas you need to be looking into. But I was going to talk about the financial side. You know, yes, I would do loads of gigs for free, but once you've done them, that's when you earn respect and that's when you build in that.
So to be clear, just to be, we're in the last...
Yeah.
A few minutes really, because we need to have time to set the band up and so on. But in terms of DK management, so you're working with an agent as well.
Yeah.
Right? So you've got this agent that you work with, you've got DK management.
Yeah.
And then you're providing all of the, you know, the transport, the equipment, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Marketing. So if a musician came to you, you know, through an audition process, is that how it happens?
Yes.
And they will get a set amount of money per gig?
Absolutely, yeah, and it would depend on your experience. And also, you know, this is really harsh, but one thing that I'm sure you're aware of is life's harsh. The music industry's harsh. If you are a singing guitarist, you are worth more to me than a drummer. Horrible, but tough. That's the way it works, because when I do marketing, if the drummer leaves, I whack another drummer in. If the singing guitarist leaves, I've got to do a new photo shoot, I've got to do a video shoot. So it's just one of those things that people become aware of the PR and the personality of the singer, effectively. So you would get, depending on your age, your experience, and where you're at, you get somewhere usually between 100 and 150 quid-ish per gig. If you did it yourself, you could easily build up to making a lot more, depending on how you wanted to run the band. But what you've got to decide is how much of your time, effort, and creativity you want to go into making money as a musician. Because I personally believe we are in the great, well, I don't believe this, this is true. We are in the greatest time. We are in the best time for being a musician in history. We are in the best time for being in a band in history. We are in the best time for making money ever. And the reason for that is because you get control. Because what used to happen in the big pie, in everywhere in the music industry, is you'd go, well, we've got the product because we're the musicians and we've built something. The problem is studios cost £1,500 a day and it takes us a month to make an album and we can't possibly afford that. On top of that, there's only one way of selling albums, which is Woolies, HMV, etc. So we've got to try and find a way of advertising on TV or radio and touring in order to then put a record out for people to buy it. So everything other than making a band is almost out of your hands. Not today. Today's amazing. You literally can make a product, then you can make the album in your bedroom for free, should you want to, or even in a studio for £150 a day. You can build the audience yourself on social media, so then all you've got to do is find a way of distributing whatever is the product you want to do, whether it's an album, whether it's music, whether it's content, whether it's video, whatever it is, all you're doing then is delivering the last slice of the pie.
So just to, because we have to move on to wind up, that positivity, you extend that to original musicians as well. You know, we've been talking about covers as well. You think this is an, positive, because a lot of your musicians go on to do
absolutely
original projects.
Yeah, and so
it's a good time for original music as well.
Unbelievable, it's the best time because you're in control, but you have to be in control. Social media is not a thing anymore. Social media is the thing. It's not a thing. And how you learn about social media should be absolutely every day, because it is the way now of you being able to distribute and build your audience. And that's the same whether it's covers or originals. And now, all of a sudden, it used to be very, very compartmentalized between covers, originals, publishing, songwriters. Nowadays, it's a very, very similar journey for so many. And that is make a great product, build a great audience, distribute the music. And it's the same thing with covers.
We absolutely could talk all day.
Yeah.
It's really, really fascinating. But we've got some bands we want to play in a bit of time, so just quickly sound check. So we're going to have a break.
Yeah, we're going to have 5 minutes.
Is there anything you wanted to say?
Only if there's any questions or anything, come and see me. Yeah, okay, yeah, that's fine, yeah.